So in this PPT, we are discussing about bottom-up parsers. So bottom-up parsers or shift-reduce parsers build the parse tree from leaves to root. Bottom-up parsers can be defined as an attempt to reduce the input string W to the start symbol of grammar by tracing out the rightmost derivations of W in reverse. This image shown in the PPT depicts the bottom-up parsers available, that is shift-reduce parsing. Shift-reduce parsing uses two unique steps for bottom-up parsing. These steps are known as shift step and reduce step. Second, the LR parser is a non-recursive shift-reduce bottom-up parser. It uses a wide class of context-free grammar, which makes it the most effective syntax analysis technique. LS parser are also known as LRK parser, where L stands for left-to-right scanning of the input stream, R stand for the construction of the rightmost derivation in reverse, and K denotes the number of look-ahead symbols to make decisions. Okay, so there are widely used algorithms available for constructing an LR parser. First one is SLR1, simple LR parser, which works on smallest class of grammar. Few number of states, hence very small table, simple and fast construction. Second is LR1 parser, which works complete set of LR1 grammar, generates large table and a large number of states, and it has slow construction. And third is LALR1, look ahead LR parser, which works on intermediate size of grammar, number of states are same in the SLR1. Now this is the next slide. So here comes the shift reduce parser. Actually, shift-reduce parser attempts for the construction of parse in a similar manner as done in bottom-up parsing. That is, the parse tree is constructed from leaves bottom to the root up. A more general form of shift-reduce parser is the LR parser. This parse requires some data structure, that is an input buffer for storing the input string, a stack for storing and accessing the production rules. So it has some basic operations such as shift, except, error. Shift, this involves moving of symbols from input buffer onto the stack. Another one is reduce. If the handle appears on the top of the stack, then its reduction by using appropriate production rule is done. Except if only the start symbol is present in the stack and the input buffer is empty, then the parsing action is called except. Whereas error, this is the situation in which parser can neither perform shift action nor produce action and not even except action. And LR parser is a bottom-up parser for context-free grammar that is very, very general, used by in computer programming language compilers and other associated tools. LR parser read their input from left to right and produces a right and rightmost derivation. It is called a bottom-up parser because it attempts to reduce top-level grammar production by building up from the leaves. And LR parser is the most powerful parser of all the deterministic characteristic parser presents. Parsing table is derived into two parts, action table and go table. So if I talk about the LR parser algorithm, LR parser is same as all the parser, but the parsing table is different for each parser. It consists of input buffer, stack, parsing table, go table, and all. Thank you. And the next slides will be explained by your Shobhashish. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I'm Shobhashish, and I will be explaining about LR0 first. So the LR0 is basically efficient bottom-up syntax analysis technique that can be used to large class of context-free grammar. This technique is called LR0. Here the L stands for left-to-right scanning, the R stands for rightmost derivation in reverse, and 0 stands for number of input symbols to look ahead. So, for constructing the LR parsing table, there are in generally three steps. So, the first step is writing the augmented grammar. The second step is a zero collection of items to be found. And the third step is defining two functions, namely goto and the action function. The goto function is the list of terminals, and the action function is the list of non-terminals in the parsing table. So It is basically a finite state machine that recognizes variable prefixes of the right sentential form is constructed. It can be used to guide the handle section in the shift register. Next slide, please. So the second type I am to explain is the SLR1 parser. So here the letters S, L and R. So S stands for simple, L stands for left, and R stands for right. The left indicates that the input is read from left to right, and the right indicates that a right derivation is read. So the SLR parser is like the smallest class of grammar and have a very few number of states. It's comparatively easier to construct. Only difference between SLR and LR0 is that in the parsing table that there's a chance of shift reduced conflict because we're getting into reduced correspondence for all terminal states in LR0 parsing. We can for the steps for constructing the SLR parsing table are also quite similar to the LR0 table. So the first step here is again writing the augmented grammar. The second step is LR0 collection of items to be found. The third is finding fall off LHS of production, and the last or the fourth step is defining the two functions, goto and action. The goto function is the list of terminals and the action function is the list of non-terminals in the parsing table. So in SLR parser, it's generally used for accepting certain types of grammar which are not accepted by the LR0 parser. Uses the same configurating set as the zero and have similar table structure and parse operation. So everything we have learned about LR0 applies in SLR1 as well.
Keeping the non-terminal elements means here the terminal elements are plus, star, ID, and the non-terminals are E, T, and F. So in our canonical canonicals, there are 8 canonical states which have been we have written down in the states section. Okay, so now let's see what is I0 states. So I0 is going to I0. From I0 we are shifting E, so in go to we will just write 1. Similarly in T also, it is going to canonical set of item states 2, and F is going to canonical item of set 3. Now again it is going to a canonical item of set 4 to ID, so we are writing S4 as it is shifting.
So in the diagram
similarly in the I1 state we are firing the terminal, so it is becoming S5 as it is going to canonical set of state I5. So we are basically we are shifting the plus operator, so we are writing S5. Now in the I2 state, what we are doing is that we are shifting the star operator to canonical set of item S6. We are shifting the star operator to canonical items S6. Okay, in this diagram we have done the whole shifting and reducing. So basically we will first see the shiftings, then we will come to the reducing part. Okay, now in I3 state we are reducing over here, so there is no shifting occurs, so it will be blank initially. It will be blank. Similarly, I4 also will be blank. I have written over here R4, R3. It is for reducing, but we will see it later why it is becoming R3 or R4. In I5 state,
the ID is going to canonical set of item state 4. So it is becoming S4. And for T, it is going to canonical set of item state 7. And for F, it is going to 3. For I6 state, it is going to canonical set of item I4 in as it is shifting the ID, so it is becoming S4. And it is going to, as it is shifting F, so it is going to canonical set of state 8. In I7, we are shifting star to canonical set of state 6, so we are writing S6. In I8, we are not doing any shifting as it has been reduced, so we are doing nothing and it is totally blank. Now all the shiftings have been done. Now let's see what are the reduced states or the final states we can also say. What means it is achieve this final state. So we will do R2. Similarly for I3, it is achieving the final state, so we are doing R3. Again, similar for R4, I7 and I8 also. Now we have seen all the steps to check whether the given grammar is LR0 or not. We have done the augmentation. We have also drawn the canonical items, and we have now also seen the parsing table. So from that diagram, we can also conclude that it is having a mixture of final state and final canonical items and the initial canonical items. So we can say that it is not a LR0 parsing, LR0 grammar. From the parsing table, we can also say that as it is having both the states, both the shifting and reducing at the same cell, so we can say that it is not a LR0 grammar. So we can prove that the given grammar is not an LR0 grammar. So that's it, the process for checking the LR0. Now the other part will be described by Subhrakanti Ghosh. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shoham. And good evening, sir. I'm myself Subhrakanti Ghosh, and I'm going to describe the CLR1 parsing table. And here is the grammar. The grammar is given like that: E equals to T plus E slash T, and T goes ID. So before going into the depth of the SLR1 parsing, we need a concept of dot operator. So basically, the need of dot operator is like that: if a variable is present at the right side of the dot operator, that means that variable needs to be checked out. And the variables that are present at the left side of the dot operator, that means that variables have been already checked out by the dot operator. And by checking every variable, the dot operator is moving from left to right. And when the dot operator is reaching out the last position of the expression or the canonical item, that means we have got the final state or the final reduced canonical item. Okay. And here is a concept of canonical items. Before going for canonical items, we need a augmented grammar for this. The augmented grammar for this expression would be E dash goes to dot E, and then E goes to dot T plus E, and E goes to dot T, and T goes to dot ID. So before going to understand the augmented grammar, we need a concept of which variables are terminal and which variables are non-terminal. So basically here you can see that the variables like T and E, that are non-terminal variable, and the terminal variables are ID and plus, and by default that is dollar sign. Okay. So basically the function of dot operator is like that: when an operator or variable is present at the right side of the dot operator, I have to check that variable is at non-terminal or a terminal. If it is a terminal variable, then I should not open that variable at the next expression. But if it's a non-terminal variable, then I have to open it up. So basically, by this funda, we will going into the depth of the canonical items. So basically, the first canonical item or the I0 is like that, E dash goes to dot E. So sir, just see dot E. Dot E means after the dot operator, E is present. E is a non-terminal variable. That means I need to open it up. Okay. So when I will open it up, it will go to E goes to dot T plus E and E goes to dot T. Okay. Now check for the dot T. Let's see, the T is a non-terminal variable. Then I need to open it up again. So T goes to dot ID. And after the dot, there is a ID. And ID is a terminal or non-terminal variable. It's a terminal variable. Then I don't need to open it up again. Okay. So it's our I0 canonical item or the first canonical item. Okay. So after that, I have already mentioned that the variables that are present at the right hand side of the dot operator, I need to check it out. Okay. So the right, so the, for the first expression, like E dot goes to dot E, there is E. So I need to check that E. So when I'm going for to check the E, so after checking the E, it is going to E dot goes to E dash goes to E dot. It's our final expression or the final canonical item for the ION. And by default, it is accepted. And dot is not present anywhere. So there is only one expression. And for T, it is going to E goes to T dot plus E and E goes to T dot. And that whole portion is called I2. So just see, E goes to T dot. I have already mentioned that when the dot operator is reaching out at the last position of the expression, that means that expression has been already fully reduced. That means E goes to T dot means that this expression is fully reduced and it is R2. Okay. So when for the E goes to T dot plus E, just see, after the dot operator, there is a plus sign. That means plus sign is a non-terminal, it's a terminal variable. Then I don't need to open it up here. Okay. After that, I have to go for checking the ID. So if I go for checking the ID, it goes to T goes to ID dot and it is I3. Just see, sir, dot operator has been reached out at the most rightmost portion of the expression and the expression is fully reduced and it is I3 and it's the canonical item name is that I3. Okay. After that, I'm checking for that E goes to T dot plus E. Now I have to check for the plus operator or the plus variable. So when we will check for the plus operator, it would be E goes to T plus dot E and sir, just see after the dot operator, there is E is present and E is a non-terminal variable. Then again, I have to open the E operator or E variable. So it will be E goes to dot T plus E and E goes to dot T and T goes to dot ID as the T is a non-terminal variable and that is present at the right hand side of the dot operator. So I have to open it. I had to open it up. And for the dot operator of ID, it is not a non-terminal variable. It's a terminal variable. So I don't need to open it up again. So it is our item number 4 canonical item. Okay. Or the I4 canonical item. For that, from I4, when I'm reading E as the E is present at the right hand side of the dot operator, when I'm reading E, it is going to E goes to T plus E dot. And it is our I5 canonical item. And just see, sir, dot operator has been reached out at the last position of the expression. That means it is fully reduced and reduced by the pi 1 means the first expression has been reduced here. Okay. And for ID, just check it out, sir. ID that is go to I3 state or the I3 canonical item state. T goes to ID dot and that is reduced again. And for the T, it is going to again the state number 2 or the canonical item 2 state. And these total I have 6 canonical items here. And now I'm going for the parsing table. Before going into the depth of the parsing table, here I need to mention that there is a minor difference between the LR0 parser and SLR1 parser. The difference is for the reduced portions. Okay, for the LR0 parser, we have written the reduced portions or the reduced forms in the action part for the whole, like where the ID was there, where the plus sign was there, where the dollar sign was there. We have written all the positions. Okay, but for this SLR1 parsing table, we will not write this. Like, we have a clear concept of follow. Okay, so what does this follow means? Like, the rule is like that. We have to check the reduced forms. Okay, like I'm just taking an example. Like, E goes to T dot. Okay, E goes to T dot. Just see, that's a pi 2. Okay, E goes to T dot. The rule says that the left hand side's follow would be taken. Okay, left hand side follow would be taken. So if I take the left hand side follow, like T dot's left is E. So E's follow would be only dollar. Just see, that's our expression. E is present here. E is present the first expression, E goes to T plus E and slash T, and E is present here, and E's follow is only dollar. Okay, and for the T and for the on more reduced form, that is T goes to ID dot, and here the T is the left position, and I need to take the follow of T. Just see, sir, T is present at the first position, E goes to T plus E and slash T. After the T, that is plus sign. That means this is the follow of T plus and dollar. So basically the follow of T is dollar and plus, and the follow of E is dollar. When I will go for the parsing table, this thing would be mostly needed, as I need to write those reduced form in the plus and the dollar sign. Okay, so going deep into the parsing table, just see, sir, I have total six canonical items, 0, 2, 5, and the action part have ID plus and dollar, and the go-to part have E and T. Basically the action part consists of the terminal portions or terminal variables, and the go-to part consists of the non-terminal variables like E and T. Just see, that's the canonical items and the flow DFD. Just see, for the zero. For zero, when the ID is given, it is going to S3. For the go-to actions, for the go-to portions, we need to write S3. It would be not applicable in the go-to portion. Okay. So for ID, it is going to S3. For plus and dollar, there is not state transformation. Okay. For E, it is going to first canonical item, and for T, it is going to second canonical item. Here we can't write the IS1 or S2. Okay. I have to write 1 and 2 only. Okay. So for the zeroth state, it is done. For the first canonical item or one, I have already mentioned that first canonical item would be by default, it would be accepted. So the accepted part would be written in the dollar sign. Okay. So it is written accepted. For the second state, sir, just see, for the plus sign, it is going to S4 or canonical item state 4. And for the dollar sign, it would be reduced. So just see the difference. For the dollar sign, it is pi 2 or the reduced 2. And for when we are using LR0 parser, we would write the pi 2 in ID, in plus, in dollar, in every bracket or in every column. But here we are just writing in that only follow part, and that is R2. And for E and T, it is not going anywhere. For the state 3, it is for the plus, it is again reduced form, and for the dollar, it is again reduced form, and for the E and T, it is not going anywhere. For the 4, it is going to S3 position or the S3 state or the S3 canonical items. And for 1, it is going to 5. And for T, it is going to 2. And for 5, for the I5 or the last canonical items, it is fully reduced by the 1 canonical item. And it is written in the dollar sign, as the dollar is the follow of E. So basically, you can see there is a no seed reducing classing in this parsing table. So basically, this is the main difference between the LR0 parser and the SLR1 parsing. And here, by this parsing table or by this clarification or by this canonical items, we can conclude that the SLR, it is the SLR1 accepted grammar. And so go to the next slide, please, Soham or Tathagata. If a state does not whether it will make a shift operation or reduced operation, and we have some for a terminal is called a shift reduce conflict or reduce shift conflict, see shift conflict or reduce conflict, the right option would be A, shift or reduce conflict. Okay, if a state does not know whether it will make a shift operation or reduce for a terminal is called. Then the second question is, which of these is true about LR0 parsing? The options are given. It is in first option is most general non-backtracking shift reducing parsing. B is it is still efficient. C, both A and B. D is none of the main sense. So it would be option C is correct, both A and B. And go to the next slide, please. Go to next slide, please. Okay. Bottom-up parser generates a leftmost derivation in reverse, B rightmost derivation in reverse, C leftmost derivation, D rightmost derivation. Here the correct option would be B, rightmost derivation in reverse. The fourth question is, which of the following is true? Canonical LR parser is LR1 parser with single look ahead terminal. All LRK parsers with K greater than 1 can be transformed into LR1 parsers, both A and B, and none of the above. The correct choice would be option C is correct, both A and B. For the last question of this whole presentation, that is, a canonical set of items is given below, S goes to L dot and greater than R, Q goes to R dot. On input symbol, the set has a shift reduced conflict and a reduced conflict, a shift reduced conflict but not a reduced conflict, a reduced conflict but not a shift reduced conflict, neither is a shift reduced nor a reduced conflict. The correct answer of this question would be option D. Okay, so we have already done the whole thing like that. If a state does not know whether it will make a shift operation or reduce for a terminal is called, for this question the right option would be A, shift reduce conflict. For the question number two, which of these is true about LR parsing? Option C would be correct. Next slide, please. Tathagata. Okay, for the third question, a bottom up parser generates a leftmost derivation in reverse, B rightmost derivation in reverse. Correct answer for this question would be option B, rightmost derivation in reverse. For the fourth question, which of the following is true? A canonical LR parser is LR1 parser with a single look ahead terminal. For this question, the option C would be correct, that is both A and B. Means canonical LR parser is LR1 parser with a single look ahead terminal, and B, all LRK parsers with K greater than 1 can be transformed into LR1 parsers. A canonical.
Okay, so I'm going to discuss about the grammar to check whether it is LR0 or not. So here is the grammar. Okay, so here is the grammar. So there are some prerequisites. So let's see what are these prerequisites. So first one, we have to know what are terminals. So basically the terminals are the are the elements like plus, okay, plus, star, these are open bracket, closing bracket, these are the terminals. Next one is the non-terminals. Non-terminals like all the variables like the variables which are in capital letters like A, B, C are the non-terminals. Again we have to know what is dot operator. Dot operator is nothing but it uses if a grammar like A tends to E plus F, so then if we put dot over here, that means the compiler which starts reading from here means that the compiler doesn't read anything. Now if dot operator is like this, that means the E has been read by the compiler or have been checked by the compiler, anything we can say. So in this way we will use dot operator. Okay, we will be using the concept shifting and reducing, so these are also very important. Shifting means when one state to another state is being shifted, we are shifting any non-terminal, then it is shifting. And reducing is when we are reaching the ultimate state or the terminal state, or we are shifting any non-terminals. Not that terminal. We will be shifting like, okay, for example, if it is something like this, id dot t tends to id dot, that means it has been reduced. Why it has been reduced? Because the dot operator has been checked all the elements of the grammar. Okay, as we can see that dot operator is present at the very end, so it can be said that id can be reduced to t, id can be reduced to t because it is a bottom up parser, so it will start from the bottom to up. Okay, so these are the some prerequisites which I'll be following in the further explanation of the LR0 function. Okay, now let's move on to the to our main question. Okay, to solve any question on LR01 LR0, basically the questions will be like whether to check the given grammar is LR0 or not. For that there are three steps. Step number one is we have to augment the given grammar. Okay, so what does it mean? Augment the given grammar means we have to put an extra rule, like e dash is dot e. This is our augmented grammar. Now as it is a augmented grammar, we have to put in all the other grammars also. So e tends to dot e plus t slash dot t tends to dot t star f slash dot f, f tends to dot id. Okay, so we created our augmented grammar. Now the second step is that to create canonical items. Okay, so let's see what are the canonical items. So before moving into that, I want to tell one thing, that these canonical items will be using the concepts of dot operator. What are the terminals, what are non-terminals? So let's see, in this grammar the terminals are plus, star and id, and non-terminals are e, t and f. I am just writing this because in future it will be helpful to us. Okay, so now let's create the canonical items. So initial phase will be this, right? Because from these we are going to create the other states also. So let me first write it down. E dash tends to dot e, e tends to dot e plus t, e tends to dot t. So e tends to dot t means here is a slash, means it is also producing dot t. So that's it, we are just describing it. Okay, then it is having t tends to dot t star f, t tends to dot f, f tends to dot id. So this is our initial state, so we are making it i0. So we are making it i0. Now we will pick each and every grammar one by one and we'll do the shifting also. If it possible we'll do shifting. So in the first grammar it is saying that if we move e, the dot operator will come at the end. So let's do it first. We shifted the e and it comes e dot. Okay. Now in the second grammar it is dot e star plus t. So if we again move t, then it will give us, so we are using the same state as the same variable is shifting. So it will become e tends to e dot start t. Now it becomes a i1 state. Now let's pick up these two grammars, because these two are going to shift t, so we are merging these two. So let's move this T or shift this T, okay, and T tends to T dot star F. Okay, now according to this reducing concept, you will be might thinking that yes, it is a reducing state. Yes, you would correctly think that it is a reducing state. So let's make it a circle and let's write it as R. Okay, write it as R. We marked it as R for our future betterment for implementing the parsing table. It will be helpful for us to identifying which are shifting and which are reducing. Okay, let's move to our next set of grammars. From here, if we shift the F, it will become just to F dot. Again, it is reducing, right? According to we have seen the reduced concept, again, ith state is also reducing. So final state, we are shifting ID. It will be coming T tends to F tends to ID dot. So it is our IFO state. Okay, let's explain again these four steps, then we will move again. So from these two from these two sets of grammars, we are shifting E. So first will be coming E dot and second will be coming E dot plus T. This is very basic. So we are making it as a one state as I1. Nextly, if we take the next set of grammars, we are shifting T. So it is becoming T dot. So again it is reducing. Again it is reducing. So and the next set and the next grammar will become T dot star F. And if we take the next grammar, we will be shifting F and it is becoming IT. Similarly, this is also occurring. I hope this part is much more clear about it, how it is shifting, and we also recognize which are the reducing states. Okay. Now another concept I want to give you, that whenever there is a variable before a dot operator, suppose I am taking a variable like E tends to E dot star T. Okay, now if we shift this plus, what will happen? We are shifting the plus. Let's see what will happen. Dot star T. Now this is a case. Now this is a case that we have seen a variable or a non-terminal before a dot element, before a dot operator. So what we will do? We will open its grammar. So what will be? We will open the grammar of T. Is it clear? Whenever the dot operator is before a non-terminal, we have to open the grammar of that non-terminal. This is the important point of these canonical items. So now let's move on. So as it is terminated, we have nothing to do as it is already being accepted. Okay, now let's see this grammar. We have to shift plus, right? We have shifted right plus. Let's see. E tends to E star dot T. Now it happens that the star, the dot operator comes before the non-terminal. Now what we'll have to do? We have to open its grammars. So what are its grammars? Its grammars are T tends to dot T star F, T tends to dot F. Now you might be thinking that, hey, here is a non-terminal and there is a dot operator, then why are you not opening its grammar? Yes, we will open its grammar. So f will be tends to dot id. Now this is a not, this is not a nor non-terminal, it is a terminal, so we are not allowed to open its grammar. Okay, so in this way we are creating another state, it's naming as i5. Okay, now from i2 this grammar has been already reduced. Now let's see this one. So we will be shifting star. So if star is shifted, then t tends to t star dot f. Now what will happen? We have to open its grammars of f. So what are the grammars of f? There is only one, that is f dot id. Now another state is created, let's name it as i6. Okay, now in i3 it is reduced, i5 is also reduced, i4 is also reduced, so nothing can be done with it. Now let's see with i5. So in i5, if we shift this t, we will be getting t tends to e plus dot t, means it has been reduced. Yeah, right, it has been reduced or not? Yes, it has been reduced, we have seen it earlier. When there is no, basically reduce means when there is no variables or no terminals are present after the dot operator, then we can say that this grammar can be reduced to this grammar, to this. Okay, this has been reduced from here also. Okay, so this has been reduced. Now if you see in this grammar, if we shift the t, so it will become t tends to t dot star f. Okay, so another state has been created, let's name it as i7. Okay, now let's move on to this grammar, t tends to dot f, which is same as i3. So let's make it like this, same as i3. It will be shifted. Now this will be also same as i4. So as id is being shifting. Okay, so this state has been traversed totally, no grammars has been left where we have not shifted anything. Now let's see the i6, as we have still left with some elements to be shifted. So this will, if we move shift f, then it will become t tends to t star f dot. So this is also reducing, and this is also reducing, right? This is also reducing. So make it as i8. And this f tends to I dot id, which we have already found, this one i4 is same, both are same. So this is our canonical items. We have drawn the canonical items. Now let's see the parser trait table. So before moving to parser table, I want to tell two things. In the parser table there are three columns. First one is, there are three columns. First one is the states, where we will be keeping our states, that is i0, i1, i2, i3, i4, i5, i6, i7, i8. Okay, now the second column will be for actions. Action. So what are these? These are nothing but the terminals. Okay, third one is go to. These are for non-terminals. Now there are some conventions of writing these, or we can say there are some conventions in filling up this table. That is, first one is, whenever we write any action, whenever we try to fill the action table, then we have to use either S or R, S of I or R of I. S of I means shifting, S of I means shifting of I, R of I means reducing of I. For example, if it is written, S4, that means the fourth state has been shifted, or the in fourth state the action had been shifted. Okay, similarly for reducing also. And in go to we will simply write the state numbers. In go to we will write the states numbers. That's it. Okay, I hope it is quite understandable. I know it becomes little messy. Okay, so this is our parser table. Let's put it down of the canonical items for our simplicity. Okay, one second, let's start filling up. So what are our states? So our states are, zero, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and eight. So zero state means I zero. Here is I zero. So E goes to I one, means in go to E, under E we have to write I. Similarly, where T goes to 2. Here F is going 3. So as it, these are non-terminals, we are writing down in go to section. This should be kept in our mind, that terminals are should be written in the action and non-terminals should be written at the go to. See, we have written the non-terminals. Yes, this quite be might confusing, that why we are writing this dollar, because it is the convention. We have to write the dollar state also. And in go to we are writing our non-terminals. Okay, and let's see what are the other states of I0. Another state is I4, that is for ID. So what I will do is that in I0 ID will be S4. Why S4? Because we are shifting the ID and making another state, I fourth state, which is I4. So we are making as IS4. Okay, so in this way we are going to fill up the other tables. First of all, I am going to write the go to as well as the shifting numbers. Then we will see the reducing also. Okay, so let's write down the shiftings. So let's see the another example. Now I5, I0 is totally complete. There is nothing to do anything. First state means I1. With I1 we have plus and making, we have shifted plus and making fifth state. So under the plus we will write simply S5. Is I1 making anything else? No, nothing is there, so we can't write anything over here. Similarly, I2 is going to follow the same table, so I'm just writing I2 also. Okay. See, in I2 there are two grammars. First one is reducing and second one is shifting. So I am writing the shifting first. So star has been shifted. So under the star, I will write, what was this? I6. So I will write S6. Okay. Similarly, I3 and I4 cannot be shifted as it has been already reduced. So there is no shifting concept is there. I3 and I4 will be blank. I5, what is I5? T has been shifted. So in T we will be writing I5 as 7. F is also being shifting to 3. So we will write 3. Okay. Another way is that we are shifting ID also. ID. Here is the ID. I5 is containing an ID also. So this ID is going this state. I4 means ID is shifted to S4. Similarly, I6 also going to ID, and F. Okay. And I7 also there is a shifting of star, so we are writing S6. Okay, so shifting is done. So our shifting is done. Now let's see what are the reducing states. First of all, the reducing state is 2. Now there is a concept I want to share is that in LR0, whenever there is any shifting or reducing, before that we have to do the numbering of the grammars. So first of all, let's do that. So here is the grammar. This grammar is number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay. And another thing is that whenever we are writing the reduce, we will write the whole column. We will write the whole row for the reduce. Okay. So these are the conventions of filling up this parser table. So I2 is reduced. So in I2 now see this I2 having grammar E tends to T. So how we will put R? Okay, we are putting R. See, we are putting R. R has been put. Now, which state or which grammar, which grammar is this reducing to? That is unknown to us. So, how can we know that? We know that the reduced grammar is E tends to T. Now, let's check over the main grammar. So, E tends to T means which grammar? Means grammar number 2, right? E tends to T. Grammar number 2, simple. So we'll put R2 here, R2, that's it. Now another fact I want to share is that when we will be writing the reducings of this table, there is no need of writing here also any go to. No need to write the reducings in the go to. Okay, I3 is also reducing. So our grammar is T tends to F. Now T tends to F means which grammar? Grammar number 4. Alright. It is the third state. Okay, so we will be writing R3. So basically this is determined by this state. I4. Now I4 is also reducing. So it will be R4. Fourth state. R4. That's it. Now I6 has been reduced. Where are the other reduced? Yes, I7 having one and I8 having one. Okay. I7 is E tends to plus T, means the first grammar it is reducing to R1. And I8 is reducing to second grammar. So R2, 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 R2. Now our parsing table is completed. So we have completed our three steps. First step is we have seen the augmented grammar, augmented of the given grammar. Then we have done the canonical items. Then we have prepared the parser table. Now, what is our question? Our question is check whether the given grammar is less zero or not. From this table, how we can predict that the given grammar is less zero or not? Now I will be discussing about it. There is a rule that whenever we are preparing our table, no cell should contain more than one item. So what it is saying that whenever we are preparing the table, each cell should contain one item only, then it is said to be as LS zero grammar. But in our case, this one is the cell having more than one item and this one is another cell more than one item, so we can conclude that it is not an LR zero grammar. So this is it, the whole description of LR zero to check whether the grammar is LR zero or not. I hope you understand this. Thank you.
Okay, so now we need to discuss about the SLR 1 grammar, and for that grammar we have a grammar like e equals to t plus e/t and t is id. Okay, before going into the depth of the SLR 1 grammar, we need to know which variables are non-terminal and terminal in this grammar. Okay, so here non-terminals are e, t. Okay, and terminal is id. Okay, and then we need to know about dot operator. Okay, so what is the need of this dot operator? I'm showing. Okay, like suppose we have a grammar like e tends to dot t plus e. Okay, here is the dot. Okay, just see, here is the dot. If any variable that is present after the dot operator, we need to check that variable. Okay, before checking, you need to know if that variable is a terminal variable or non-terminal variable. If I see that that variable is a non-terminal variable, then I have to open it. Okay, if I open it, t, let's see, I have to write t is id, because it's a non-terminal variable, na? I have to open it up. Like if I go for dot id, okay, id is a terminal variable, that means I don't need to open it. Okay, and that is the need of this dot operator. Basically the main funda of this dot operator is that the variables that are situated at the left side of this dot operator, that means that variables have been already checked out. Okay, and the variables that are situated at the right side of the dot operator, that means we need to check out those variables. And when after checking, like it is checking, and after checking each variable, the dot operator will move on at the right side. Okay, so now if I after fully checking, the dot operator has reached at the last position. Okay, right, this. That means I have fully checked that all variables present in this grammar. Okay, that means that is fully reduced. Okay, these are the some basic fundas for this SLR1 grammar, and there is one more funda that is I need more canonical items for this grammar, and I'm showing these of all of these canonical items here. Okay, for these we need to go for first an augmented grammar, and that augmented grammar is the main basic thing of this SLR on parsing. Okay, so what is the augmented grammar for this grammar? Let's see, the augmented grammar is e dash dot a. Just see, we need to take e and e, that both those e would be same. Okay, and then e should be t plus e, e is equals to t and t is id, and that is called augmented grammar. Augmented grammar, okay, clear? That means here is the, it is the one extra expression, one extra expression I have to take here. Okay, I have taken here. Okay, so now I'm going to make some canonicals items, like canonicals. Canonical items. Okay, I think the canonicals item, I'll write it the left position. Okay, here, canonicals item. How to make canonical items? I'm showing here. Okay. So these so just see these augmented grammar, and from here I'm making the canonical items. So first, that is e dash goes to dot e. Now let's see, that is dot e, and e is terminal or non-terminal variable? It is non-terminal variable. That means I need to open it up. Okay, and there is a name of this open it up, it is called go to action. Okay, go to action, and I will talk it about later. Okay, so it is e dash goes to dot e, means it is a non-terminal variable. That means I need to open it up. So open it. When I open it, it would be e is t plus e, and I have to place this dot here, and there is more expression that t, e goes to dot t. Okay, as it is a non-terminal variable, and I have to open it. Now see, is dot t is a terminal variable or non-terminal variable? Yes, it is a non-terminal variable. Then I have to open it up again. So t is dot id. And now see, id is a terminal or non-terminal variable? Yeah, it's a terminal variable. Then I don't need to open it up. Okay, so this is called i0. It is a i0 canonical item. Okay, so now which variable is here? Like here it is e. Okay, now I have to check e, as I have told already that the variables that are present on the right hand side of this dot operator, I have to check it out. Okay, so here it is e, then I have to check it. So go for e. When I going for e, that is e dash goes to e dot. Like see, dot e has present anywhere? No. There is no position. That is present only one position. That is e dot. So it is going for e dot goes to dot e dot. E dash goes to e dot, and we are calling it i1. By default, this is fully accepted. And by default, this is accepted. Okay, just write accepted. Okay, and it is e dot. And you don't need to move this operator again and again, because it is already reduced. Okay, I have done for e. Now go for t. Okay, so if I go for a t, then that would be e goes to t dot plus e, and just see here is also dot t is present, then I have to move it again. So e is t dot. Okay, so that is called i2. Just see this portion, I have mentioned that e goes to t dot, that means it is fully reduced, as dot operator has been reached at the last position of this expression, that is fully reduced, i2. Okay, now go for id. If I go for id, then it would be t id dot. Means id has been already checked, and the dot operator has been reached out at the last position of this expression, and so it is fully reduced, and it is i3. Okay, it is fully reduced. It is fully reduced. Now I have to go for this portion, I2. I2 is one portion. It's not fully reduced now. Okay. So now I have to again. Now after dot operator, which operator is present or which symbol is present? That is plus. And here terminal is already plus also. Okay. It's a plus terminal. Okay. What is present here? It is plus. So plus is a terminal or non-terminal? Yes, it's no, it's a terminal variable. So go for this again. E goes to t plus dot e. Okay, means plus has been read out and there is a dot operator before e. Now see, after the dot operator e is present, is terminal or non-terminal? Yes, it is a non-terminal variable. Then I have to open it up again. So e should go for dot t plus e. Okay, then and e should go for dot t. And now see, dot t and dot t, t is a non-terminal or terminal variable? Yeah, it's a non-terminal variable. Then I have to open it up again. So t goes for dot dot id. Okay, dot id. Now see, id is a terminal or non-terminal variable? Yeah, it's a terminal variable. I don't need to open it up again. Okay, so it's a i4. It's i4. Okay, so I have opened it up i4. Now from it, see, there is a dot operator before the e. So now I need to check e. Yes, I need to check at e. Okay, so go for the checking of e. If I check e, that would be e tends to t plus e dot, and it is fully reduced. Okay, and that is i5, fully reduced as the dot operator has been reached at the last position of the expression. Okay, now if I reduced, if I go for the id, see, if I id, if I check for the id, it would be t goes to id dot. Id dot means the same expression as i3, and it is fully reduced. So for this id. Okay, and if I go for the t dot t or t, see, t dot t, if I go for the dot t, it would be e goes to t dot plus e, and then e goes for t dot, and I have already mentioned here it. And so for dot t, it will go to the i2 or the second state. Okay, and this is all the, these are all the canonical items here. Now I'm going for the parsing table. Before going for a parsing table, you need to have a knowledge of follow and first, because here the follow up, the knowledge of the follow is more important. So in the LR0 parser, which things we have done, the reduced form, we have written all the reduced form in the action parts, like the non-terminal in the terminal parts. Okay, so there is a confusion between it will be accepted or not accepted, but here this thing will not occur. Okay, why it will be not occurred here, I am showing here. So basically I have to see which grammars are, or which grammars are, or which expressions are fully reduced. So see, is t dot, it's a fully reduced, that is i2. T goes to id dot, it is fully reduced. E dash is e dot, it is fully reduced. And e goes to t plus e dot, fully reduced. Here I need to go for the follow. Okay, the main find of follow is here, or the reduced, where in which action form we will write the reduced form, there is a finder. And the finder is that we need to write the follow of the left hand side of the expression. Okay, so like if the expression is e t dot, e goes for t dot, then I need to know the follow of e. So you know the follow of e, what it be, follow of e, just see, follow of e, what would be the follow of e? That is only by default, and it is dollar. Okay, it is dollar. Then for t, id for t, it is good for id dot. Then I need to know the follow of t. Then t goes to id dot. Then I need to know the follow of t also. The follow of t goes for, let's see, what is the t are present here? Here is the t, and here is the t. And the follow of t, it is plus. Okay, right, plus. And Is there anything after the T? No, there is nothing. So by default, it is dollar. Okay. So it is plus and dollar. Okay. It is plus and dollar. That means when the expression comes for 2 or 3 or 4, those things are reduced. Okay. Then we need to write those reduced form at the place of dollar and plus. Okay. So now I'm going for the parsing table. What the parsing table? This is ID, this is plus, this is dollar, these are action part, and these are go to part, means the non-terminal variables for E and T, and the states are 0, 1, 5, no? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, now I'm filling the full parsing table. Just see, for I0 state, okay, for I0 state, that is 0, okay, if I go for the ID, it is going through, it is going to I3 state. For the action part, I need to write like S3, okay. For plus, it has no movement, and for dollar it has no movement, and for the go to actions like E and T has here, for E it is going to I1 position, and that we need to write like this 1, not I1 or not S1, just S will be written in the action part, not in the go to part, okay. And for T it is going to I2, means second, okay. And for now I'm coming to the I1 and it is seen, it is fully accepted. So we write accepted at the dollar sign position, okay. So just write accepted, okay. Now go for the second, and second is E goes to T dot, and it is fully reduced, okay. It is reduced, okay, fully not, it is reduced, okay, and that is I2. So where I should write the reduced form, so go for the T dot, and the left hand side is E, and I need to write the reduced form at the left hand side's follow part, and the left hand side is E, so E is follow part is dollar, so at the dollar position I need to write reduced, right, reduced, so it is reduced, okay. And for plus sign it is going to I4, means I need to write S4, okay. So now for going to third stage, and that is T goes to ID dot, and so here the same thing will be written here. So the follow up T, I need to know the follow up T, that is plus and dollar, as T is ID dot, and the left hand side is T, and I need to know the follows of T, and in those follows I need to write the reduced forms, okay. So at the fourth, so third, that is plus and dollar, so I have written at the plus position reduced, and the dollar's position is reduced, at least that, as this is fully reduced, the dot operator is the has reached the last position, okay. So, and for the go to expression there is nothing, for it is not going anywhere for E and T. For number four stage, for ID it is going to I3, so S3 stage, okay. For E it is going to 5, yeah, it is going to I5, means 5. And for T, that is going to second stage, to 2, okay, 2, okay. For 5, see, it is fully reduced now, yeah, it is fully reduced, and the left hand side is E, and the follow B is dollar, and I need to write the reduced form at the dollar sign, okay. So it is reduced. So now just see, there is a no clashing between the reduced form and the transform stages. So it is the SLR1 parser, okay. So if you compare it with the LR0 parser, okay, there is a comparison is like that. I started the video by saying that there is a minor difference, and the difference is here, the reduced portions. In the LR0 parser, we have written the reduced form at the action part fully, like at the ID part it would be reduced, and the action part it would be reduced, and the dollar part it would be reduced. For that, and the, for the plus sign, it is already going for S4 stage. So there will be S4 and reduced. That is a clashing, na? Yeah, that is a clashing. And for that clashing, that would be not LR0 parsing accepted. Okay. And for not clashing, and here the classing is absent for this portion, for this follow part. Okay, for this follow part. That's why I told you to know the concept of follower first. Okay, so this was the fully SLR1 parser grammar. Okay, and I have seen all the things that are needed to describe this grammar. And the grammar is already SLR1 parser and it is accepted. So thank you, sir.